Welcome back, everyone, for another episode of ISSA Talks. Super excited to be talking about the content that we're going to talk about today and to have the guests that we have today. A lot of people have been asking us for more content on women's fitness. It's something we've definitely kept in the back of our mind. We want to make sure that we talk more about it and hopefully can make a certification for it soon. But to kind of get the conversation started, we have with us an amazing guest who Dan Duran, my podcast co-host, referred me to, and he loves our guest. So I'm super excited I was able to track her down and get her on our show. We have Farel Hruska with us. Hello.
Hi, how are you?
Good. And I totally said your name wrong. It's Farel. Sorry.
It's Farel. It's okay. It's a strange name.
No, I love it. It's beautiful. Oh, I think it's absolutely beautiful. Well, thank you for joining us, Farel. Can you tell our viewers a little bit about yourself?
Absolutely. So I have been in the fitness industry for close to 20 years. It's odd to say that. And my main focus has been pre and postnatal fitness, and then specifically as that relates to women in general. I have been in the industry working on the updated guidelines and considerations for training the female athlete. And when I say athlete, I mean, honestly, all females. We go through a lot of interesting iterations physically, mentally, and emotionally throughout our lives. As an athlete, that is the most appropriate term. I have been lucky enough to be an international presenter and educator, not just in women's health, but in all aspects of, you know, functional training and programming. In addition to right now being the director of education and culture for a gym company, family-owned company called Choose Fitness. So really excited to be here and extremely passionate. If it isn't already apparent, it will be in the next few minutes about women's health and women's programming and fitness training and how important that is.
I love that. And your passion is welcome because a lot of people have questions and there are so many differences. And we'll dig into that in our two-part series with you. We'll dig into the differences in females and males and like why that matters. It does matter.
It does.
Yeah. So there's a lot of information about out there about it. Let's start talking about it. So there's some obvious differences between male and females, yes. Mentally, physically, emotionally, all the things that you just mentioned, right. But can you give us more detail? And let's start with like the physical differences.
Right. I think that if you're going to be looking at the physical differences, there are just some base differences in terms of just skeletal structure, meaning wider pelvis, greater Q angle at the femur. A lot of different changes that are just kind of base level differences. As that relates to training, I think that we also need to look at the female body and all the iterations that happen throughout their journey in life, because it isn't just a set physicality that we're training. It's a physicality that's training as it iterates throughout her lifetime. Yes. So the physical changes have a lot to do with puberty. They have a lot to do with pre and postnatal, if that's the journey that she chooses to go on, or that's the journey her body goes through. Not all female frames do. And then, of course, at the latter end, I hate to say tail end because there's a mindset around menopause. It isn't the end. It's just another change. And so to look at, you know, where each of those kind of timestamps affect the physicality of her frame, it's really important because it also generates changes in hormones. Yes. And so when it comes to how we train female identifying folks, it's really about where she is in her lifetime, what her work, life, sport journey looks like. Because to be honest, if you're training somebody pre and postnatal, it's going to be something different than training somebody who's maybe in their perimenopause or menopause state. And a lot of it has to do with kind of what life is asking her to do. So the physicality of motherhood is different from the physicality of, you know, working through menopause, for example. So a really understanding, I guess, on a much deeper level, which might speak to a certification later on, is really where is she in the journey of that? Because when you train a man, you really don't want to diminish the male frame versus the female frame. However, the female frame is a lot more complicated and has a lot more changes. A woman's body will change more in 9 months than a man's will in his entire lifetime. So again, it's not to simplify training a man, but it is a little bit more straightforward. So understanding that piece of it is so important, mission critical, actually.
Absolutely. Now, a lot. So I really want to dive into some hormones, too, because you and I have kind of talked offline about it. And hormones like drive a lot of our physiology and people don't realize that. It's incredible how many hormones impact the way that our physiology responds. And for example, estrogen and proestrogen and things like that affect our growth as females in our hips, for example, like when we go through puberty, which changes your Q angle that you mentioned earlier, which changes the way that your knee works, right? And your hip works and the impact that exercise and activity will have on our knees and our hips. So can you talk to us a little bit about some of the different hormones that trainers should be aware of and how they impact our physiology?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it is definitely more than a conversation in terms of just sort of like labeling the hormonal changes as it relates to where a woman is, because to be honest, as you, I would assume, know, also because you live it, is that even in a month frame, time frame, the hormonal changes that happen, and as it relates to muscle tone, as it relates to muscle activation, you know, there's just a lot that can change within, you know, 28 to 30 days. But I think that understanding the fact that we have obviously a larger amount of estrogen, progesterone, less testosterone, doesn't mean that that's like the blanket for every female frame. You know, many of us have iterations of those hormones as well. I think one of the things that, and this comes to such a basic understanding and yet still is misunderstood, is that when we're training females, it is a lot harder to increase or get to hypertrophy than it is for males. And I think that still is even though it's basic understanding, it still is a myth and misconception, both with our clients and also with our trainers, like fearing heavy weight, fearing, you know, adding in additional training sessions for fear of bulking up, so to speak.
Sure.
And so just to understand that base level, just, you know, I know that you're in a competitive training space and I'm sure you can speak to how much time and how much energy it is to get to the space where you are at a competitive level. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of trainers and women fear the heavyweight, fear the intense, type of training because they have this mindset that it's just, you know, all of a sudden you're going to be this, you know, massive frame. It's very, very difficult for females to get there. And I think that's a positive and a negative in terms of like mindset.
Sure.
I'd like for more women to understand that lifting heavy is a very, very positive mindset, not to fear it. But from a hormonal standpoint, I also think that as you mentioned, from puberty into pre-postnatal into perimenopause, those hormonal fluctuations affect so much. I mean, just to even look at the magical hormone of relaxin that is present during pre and postnatal, it can stay in the body up to 12 months postnatal. Well, that one hormone offers great benefits in terms of ligamentous laxity. It allows for the pelvis to expand, breast tissue, uterine tissue, all that, but it affects every joint, all connective tissue, right? So instability, hypermobility, greater range of motion, which can lead to injury, and that's just all in this one little chapter of a woman's life. So really diving into in every aspect of her journey throughout her lifetime, where do hormones play? And then even diving in deeper, where are they in that like month period of time and how that will affect her programming? I know that that's a larger answer, but it's nuanced.
Absolutely. And in part two of our episode, I really want to talk more about the specifics of training a client, because to your point, month by month, it can vary within those 28 to 30 some days.
Exactly.
Right? Absolutely. Yeah. And there's different periods of when our hormones are fluctuating that we should pay attention to and understand how our body is responding to that. Correct.
Exactly. Yeah.
So very interesting. I think that a lot of people don't take these things into account. And to your point, they train every client, male, female,
right,
you know, young, old, they all train them the same.
Right.
Right. And that's not necessarily something that we should be doing. Also with females, you mentioned the emotional and the mental differences. Mm-hmm. What are some of those that we should be aware of?
Again, I want to be careful because I really don't want to oversimplify training a man. Or overcomplicate training a woman. However, decades of training women, it's become much more apparent that it takes more on a mental and emotional level for consistency, for adherence to a programming, and then also even just within a specific training session, because women, I'd like to think of us as more complex. I don't think complicated is the right word, but complex is. We are so much more, I believe, mentally and emotionally driven to bring intensity, to bring even just to show up. And that really falls into us needing to understand how it affects us on a deeper level. For a man, it's mostly straightforward. You know, this is the goal and this is how you get there. And then you implement the programming. For a woman, it's like, well, this is the goal. This is how you get there. But why? And I mentioned that it's when I was training trainers to train women, you know, it deepens the experience. If you were to say, okay, so from a postural standpoint, we want to make sure that we're strengthening the upper back, mid to lower trapezius, rhomboids, and that involves, you know, scapular retraction. And they're like, yes, great, I'm in, right? And this is mostly if you're training somebody in that motherhood phase. Okay, so now as you pull back, I want you to squeeze the shoulder blades together. Think about cracking a walnut between your shoulder blades, really open up the chest. Great, I'm in just a little bit more. Okay, great. So as you do that, that's going to affect the way that you hold yourself. You'll have less muscle fatigue and pain. Interesting. Okay, I'm in just a little bit more. And as you're holding your child and you're going through life and kind of working, it's going to help with that postural challenge. You're going to feel less muscle fatigue and pain, and you're going to feel a lot more energy as you're taking care of your child. Got it. Better mom. This feels better. I'm going to operate. You know, so there's like these levels that need to be kind of infused in the training so that folks, women, understand how it's going to affect them on a deeper level versus necessarily, and again, not to diminish, but just the aesthetics, right? It's like, this means more to me. And for women, my experience has shown that matters a lot more to them. The physicality, great. I love that we're going to get there. What does this mean for my life? What does this mean for me as a human? What does this mean for me as a woman? So the mental and emotional piece is huge. And I think trainers understanding that is going to help them with adherence with clients. You know, someone, if there's a woman who's training with someone who gets them, they'll be back.
Yes. And that's, I agree with that wholeheartedly. As a sports coach, something that I've learned every single time I go through some kind of like training or whatnot as a volleyball coach or as a strength coach, they tell us that men or male athletes, they have to battle to bond is the way they say it. It has to be competitive to really work together as a team. And then females, we are the reverse. We have to bond to battle.
Yes.
We have to have that relationship. So like in a client trainer relationship, there has to be a relationship there for them to adhere to what you're telling them, for them to buy into what you're telling them. But I love that you brought that up, the fact that we have to kind of explain things potentially a little bit differently to a female client for them to, you know, really have that buy-in.
Right. Well, there's a layer of trust that I think is unique to all humans, but I think a little bit more to females. It's like there's an element of, you know, I use intimacy, but not in the true, you know, the sense that we usually use it. But just, you know, if you're going to connect with me and you're going to help me through this journey of my, you know, physical journey for a woman, that's not a surface experience. That is, you know, being vulnerable and transparent and scary sometimes, even just to start a program that says, I want help or I need help or, you know, I don't know what I'm doing. So that trust is huge. And I love that bond to battle. That's brilliant. Yeah.
Yeah. And it takes me like down a whole rabbit hole of like the neurology of coaching and how we learn and the fact that our brains need to feel safe.
Yeah. Right?
Safe means different things to different people.
100%. Right?
So yeah, for a lot of my female clients, I find that too. They have to feel like nurtured and cared for and safe in that space in order for them to excel in that space. And you pointed it out. It takes a little bit more, for example, if they're trying to hypertrophy or bodybuild, like what I do, you can't just throw them in the gym and be like, here, go lift all this weight and, you know, have fun. You're going to do great. Right. It's a longer process. So to get somebody's buy-in for that process, there has to be an emotional relationship. There has to be a little bit of a bond between you and your trainer in order to make that happen.
Absolutely.
And I've experienced that personally. Like I've trained coaches so many times. You know, there's some coaches that I just didn't connect with, right. They didn't sit well with me. So I finished my contract with them and I moved on to somebody else. Right. And I found a coach now that's another female competitor. We connect really, really well. We have great conversation. You know, I feel safe with her. I feel like she knows me and understands me.
Yeah.
So I love that.
The difference. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. And so these mental aspects, so when somebody buys into their program, they have that feeling of efficacy, essentially. They understand what they're doing. They understand how this is going to impact them. What would you say would be the overall impact on their fitness program, no matter what their goal is?
Well, I mean, honestly, the kind of alluding to what we were just talking about, and that is when someone feels, a woman feels seen, a woman feels understood, a woman feels safe, as we've used before, not only are they willing to go into this space, which can be very vulnerable, but they're willing to come back to it. And so when it comes to the intensity that they choose to give, when it comes to the consistency that they choose, it, all of that is rooted in, am I understood? Am I seen? Am I safe? And so how that affects the outcome of the programming is night and day. If someone feels good about being with a trainer that gets them and that guides them through from a mental and emotional space, not just physical. I mean, it's everything for someone to show up and really be present. And that takes that step into knowing them and feeling safe to be known. And, you know, not to go into a huge psychological conversation, but it doesn't take much, to be honest. You know your stuff as it relates to her, what she wants to get out of it. And then also allow for there to be a personal relationship. Now, I want to make sure that I'm clear that it's an appropriate personal relationship. Yes. Right? There's guidelines, there's boundaries, there's, you know, that also speaks to safety. But you're willing to spend some time to know them, to ask them how they are, to remember something that they said in the last session, to bring that back up and ask, hey, I know that last time you said you're going to be doing this. How did that go? You know, those are little nuggets that I think all humans deserve, but specifically females, to know that they matter. And that's what's going to lend, you know, greater intention, greater intensity, even in the programming that you've created, because they know, they feel as if they belong.
Absolutely. And Farel, all the things you're talking about are the things that we, like the intangibles that we try and teach our trainers, right? Because you can program your butt off, right? You can show up every day on time. You can be dressed to the nines. Yeah. You can deliver a great program. But what about the interpersonal relationship?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That interpersonal aspect. And we kind of have to master that. And this is why it's important that we're making sure to address these things.
Right.
And circling back to pre and postnatal, I actually kind of have a question that's a little bit off script.
Okay.
You talked about the hormone relaxin and how it changed the laxity in our ligaments you know, up to 12 months after having a baby. Yeah. So when someone's working with a client, a lot of people tell us that they're nervous to work with a pregnant client or somebody who just had a baby. What are some other things that they should consider and kind of put them at ease that it's okay to work with a pre and postnatal client? It's not scary,
right?
But you know, what would be your number one recommendation as far as working with that type of client?
Yeah. You know, it's so interesting to me, Jenny, because there's still this, trepidation and I get it. It's a very, you know, interesting and, just huge transitions, not just in a woman's body and life, but obviously in this human that's being grown, in the body as well. I want to just make sure there's a blanket statement that it's not just okay to train a woman during a healthy pregnancy. It's recommended. And so let's just start there. I do want to make sure that I say in a healthy pregnancy, because there are considerations, contraindications based on how her pregnancy is looking, and that will be dictated oftentimes by a physician. So in a healthy pregnancy, it's not just okay. It's actually something that is beneficial for both her journey and then also for baby's journey as well. And there's just so much research that we could dive into, which again, you know, warrants another even certification in that space. But I think the nerves come back to myths and misconceptions. I usually joke that most of these myths and misconceptions come from mother-in-laws, and I don't know why, but they tend to like, why are we listening to them? Anyway. And then also understanding the research and knowing the benefits from a cardiovascular to musculoskeletal standpoint on training a woman through pregnancy and into postpartum. Nervousness also goes back to this myth that fitness caused an issue, when in reality an issue was probably there already and was destined to play out the way that it was based on the body and the baby's health. So while that's, we can understand that on a cognitive level, there's still a base like nerve around, you know, what if I cause harm? Mm-hmm. And really when we're training during the pre and postnatal space, it always comes back to how a woman feels in that exercise, in that programming, in that month, in the rehabilitation after having a baby. So it, more than anything, it still speaks back to, are you asking the questions? Does she feel safe? Can she feel confident to speak up if something doesn't feel right? You know, oftentimes when we're training someone who maybe hasn't been active during her lifetime, it's a different journey than sure. someone who is an athlete. So for example, I don't know if you plan on having babies, but if you plan on having babies, my journey with you would be more of, let's continue what you've been doing. If it starts to not feel right, then we'll diminish intensity, but let's keep you on the path that you've been on. So really it depends on the person and where they are, but what we're offering is such an amazing service. And to be honest, there's a psychological component, as there always is, with women in the prenatal phase, because something shifts where she recognizes it's not just about me anymore. Yeah. This is about me and this other being. And when we can infuse healthier habits during the prenatal portion of her life, she is likely then to continue those habits postnatally and the rest of her life, because she is psychologically primed to be making change. Because prior to that, it was all just about her, and she might be motivated and then she might not. And the greater why isn't as concrete as it is when she's in that prenatal phase. And so when a trainer is able to be in a woman's life during that time, there's this really bigger picture that is available to that experience, that this could be something that she carries throughout her life. And think about the fact that then that also connects to how a child is then raised, because when a woman is caring for herself, when a woman is taking care of herself, that is something that children start to mirror. So it's just this generational impact that can be changed. You know, there are many women that have come from deconditioned families, you know, genetics that, man, they didn't ask for. And they got to a point in their life and says, this stops with me. And they start to change generations of behaviors or mindsets just because they recognize that this is an opportunity for change. So from a hormonal standpoint, yes, but mental and emotional, it's a incredible opportunity. And if you're a trainer that is, that has that ability to have someone feel safe, and you can train them effectively, it could be a massive generational impact.
Absolutely. And what you just said is so powerful, that mm-hmm. the way that especially females, but fathers also can affect the way their children respond. But when they see their mom being healthy and, you know, making good food choices, exercising regularly, things like that, the children are more likely to do that as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely. My, you know, my children knew their anatomy at a very young age, you know, and understanding their bodies and celebrating their strengths. And it was play. It was something that was fun. As opposed to, you know, there are a lot of family dynamics where it's something, well, I have to go work out or I have to, whatever. It's, you know, when they see mom doing it, mom getting joy out of it, that's something that children emulate, and that can change lifetimes.
Absolutely. Yeah. I was trying to teach people, especially with nutrition, like mm-hmm. you're in control of it. Oh, my kid eats candy all the time. Well, where's your kid getting the candy?
Right.
Go to the store and buy it. No.
Right. And can we not reframe what a treat is? And is that a fresh strawberry? You know, because that is like candy if you look at it in the right way. Yeah.
Absolutely. And so speaking of food, I want to touch base a little bit on the nutrition aspect for females. Okay. So in the way that we teach it in the personal training course, the portion sizes, for example, for men are twice what they are for females, just because generally women have smaller body sizes than males, less muscle tissue, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So generally the calorie needs are going to be lower for a female. Sure. What are the things should a nutrition coach or a personal trainer be aware of as far as nutrition recommendations for a female client versus a male client?
Right. Well, I think in all transparency, I don't have a nutrition degree or a registered dietitian. So really my mindset is more of, if you're going to be generally speaking, it's feed for performance versus feed for anything else. So eating clean, is probably the biggest component to it. I don't know if I'd necessarily speak to caloric intake, because a lot of it has to do with the specificity of a woman's goals, and then also where she is in her journey. So like pre and postnatal is very different, especially if she's going to be breastfeeding. So from a caloric standpoint, I'll put that to the experts in that space. But from a nutrition standpoint, especially when it comes to, as it relates to mirroring what we want our children to do, it's eating clean and eating for the joy of flavor and nutrition and nourishing the body. That would be my take on that.
Absolutely. I agree. So stick to the outsides of the grocery store,
exactly,
right?
Exactly. Which is crazy enough where the wine is usually, but that's fine.
True. Yeah, it's true. Depending on where you're at. Yeah. It's in the far right on the outside. Yep. Hey, they say a little bit of wine isn't going to hurt you. Right? Just not all day, every day.
Right.
Yes. Yeah. So I think that's super valuable advice, Farel, to stick with whole foods. Yeah. And that can be hard for a lot of us, depending on how we were raised, right? But you're absolutely correct that we can affect the next generation by making better choices.
Exactly. And I think that, you know, speaking to how folks were raised and then also just equity of what's available, that can play into that. And so I think that for a lot of our trainers, you know, maybe we were trained on at this higher level of like what proper nutrition looks like and organic and where we can get it. Well, let's look at what's equitable in terms of who we're training and how we're training. And sometimes going from, you know, understanding that a vegetable is a vegetable. And if in your journey, a vegetable in a can is important because that's all you have access to versus, you know, something that's more processed out of a box, like that's okay. Let's make baby steps too. We don't have to have this lofty view of what nutrition is. Let's just start going towards a direction where there's better understanding. I think that sometimes as trainers and especially in the fitness industry, we tend to have the pendulum swing all the way to the side where it's like, well, this is the best. Well, it takes steps to get there. And there's steps to understanding, there's budgetary concerns, there's, you know, there's access concerns. So let's baby step all of this and not feel like, well, if you're not doing it here, high and to the right, then you're failing. So yeah. from a nutrition standpoint, I think that's, we need to have some grace in that process. And being real, you know, because if, you know, I think there was a statistic, it was several years ago, but it was, something like in the US, there's only about 20% of our population that come to a gym. Now, there are other ways that folks can exercise.
Sure.
So that's probably not exact. However, if that's the case and a very small portion of our population actually have access, then we need to change the way that we're talking. Because if access means, you know, these beautiful facilities and amazing equipment and high levels of education, then where is the 80% feeling as if they even have a journey or a path? And so, you know, instead of us being like, well, this is the ultimate, how do we get there? How do we widen that doorway? How do we shorten the runway to get to just general understanding of health and fitness? So I think that's a whole nother dialogue, but I think that's something that we need to be talking about as trainers.
Absolutely. And I always say making better, bad choices.
Yeah. Right?
Sometimes better is better.
Yeah.
And to your point, it may not be going from, you know, no fruits and vegetables to you have to go and get go to Whole Foods and get, exactly, you know, a cantaloupe, right? What about canned melon or what about, you know, canned peas, right?
Yeah, right.
And sometimes that's better and that's right. Better.
That's better. Exactly. And that's win. That's success, that's right?
Yeah.
And even just understanding like, oh, let's just add more color to our food, natural color. Great. Winning, you know?
Absolutely. And I appreciate what you're saying about gym access too, because I don't think I've ever thought about it like that, Farel, where like, because I don't remember my mom going to a gym or my dad going to a gym when I was growing up. I didn't start going to the gym until I had access to a rec center in college.
Yeah. Right.
Right. And then I went every day because I was like, this is awesome. Like, I'm paying for it. I'm going to go. And I literally went every day from 9 p.m. They kicked us out at 11.
Nice.
And then I got a gym membership, right? But again, to your point, there's not always a gym nearby. And some people can't afford a gym membership,
exactly,
especially if you have a family, right? That gets really expensive. But there's also, like, for example, rec centers in your local area or a park, right? And it doesn't have to be equipment that you're using.
Right.
But a quick example, when I was training my college athletes, the men's team, we got locked out of the building. So we had to work out outside, but thank goodness I had all my hurdles and all this stuff. So we set it up outside. Some of them were barefoot because I didn't have the right shoes, whatever. And then this park that we were at has like little like push-up bars and then a sit-up station with like a like special rubber matting so that you can do your sit-ups. Yeah. And then they had like this thing that looked like one of those old school gazelles out there. Yeah, and there was somebody on it the whole time we were out there working out. I was like, good for you. It's free. It's in a local park near you and you're doing something.
Exactly. Right?
Better is better.
Yes. Well, I mean, think about just even just a standard playground. There's a park bench for push-ups, tricep dips, step-ups. There's a swing maybe where, you know, you can put your feet on it and do, you know, some plank crunches and curls in a plank position. There are ways that you can do, you know, decline or incline pull-ups. Like there are just so many things you can do. And that's the kind of conversation that needs to happen, or even just someone in their living room, you know, just look around and have that mental access. In other words, know that there are things that are around you that you can start moving and doing things. And you talk about accessibility. It's one thing to have a gym that is near you or a rec center that you can afford. Do you have the mental and emotional access to put your hand on the door, open it and walk in, to be seen, to not necessarily know what you're doing? Like sometimes that's the scariest thing on the planet. And, you know, to be honest, I've been in the industry for close to 2 decades. I still have trepidation. If I'm walking to a gym that I don't know the people, I don't know the layout, and I'm opening the door and it's like, it might as well be naked. Like, I'm just so like vulnerable and like, oh my gosh, you know, and I've been in the industry. I know what I'm doing. And yet there's still that. So imagine someone who's never even addressed their own physicality, let alone they could afford it. There's an access to the gym or rec center. Walking up and opening the door might be one of the scariest things. So there's a lot of things that we can work on dismantling in terms of like what it should look like to even just work on your health and wellness.
Yes. Oh, I think I'm going to have you back to have a whole conversation about this, because I think this is gold, what we're talking about.
It is. And I think that we have a lot of opportunities in our industry to do better and to make sure that we're reaching more people.
Absolutely. It starts with each one of you guys that are watching this, right? Absolutely. We're the people that can help affect change and help people feel more comfortable.
Absolutely.
Yeah. To your point, I've been in the industry for, 13 years now. I've been working out heavily for 20, 25 years. Yeah. And for me, it's the biggest thing is if I don't know the layout of the gym that I'm going to, I get anxious.
Yes.
But I don't know where anything is. And I don't want to look like, wait, it's all perception. I don't want to look like I don't know what I'm doing, right?
You know more than anyone what you're doing. And I think that's what we need to keep considering is we are all humans having a human experience. And every single day, almost every hour, that experience can change. And so how are we showing up for each other? You know, and are we creating spaces, relationships, experiences where someone can belong, not fit in, but belong? How they show up, how they are in their world, and know that this is home. We have work to do, but having that awareness is critical. And your own awareness as a trainer, right? Mm-hmm. What are your stereotypes? What are your unconscious biases? What do you think when someone walks into a gym in a bigger body? Do you just make an assumption? Have you just, because if you did, check yourself.
Absolutely.
And you know, unconscious bias, it lives in all of us. Mm-hmm. So, you know, how are we, you know, are we part of that trepidation because of some sort of energy that we show or show up with?
Absolutely. So I have one final question for you, relating it to what we're talking about and relating it to female clients specifically.
Right.
Is there value, and I know this is kind of a loaded question, is there value in a trainer asking a female client or any client really, during that initial interview or throughout their training protocols, how are you feeling? And what concerns or what anxieties do you have?
Yes. Yes. I mean, I think that, that is something that is mission critical in the initial intake. Mm-hmm. And as you progress, because those feelings are going to start to change. And in some ways they might lead to, adjustments in how we're training, adjustments in where and the timing of how we train. And then also it leads to a greater sense of trust, because if there's a constant check-in, a constant, and not when I say constant, I mean consistent, really, that this person who is in your care really does feel as if the journey that they're on and how they're feeling throughout it, not just physically, but mentally and emotional, is important to the trainer. Again, that adds to the trust, the relationship, the sense of security. And that's also going to open doors to feeling safe enough to then add intensity, to then say, yeah, I'm ready for that now. Or have we thought about, like, they're going to be part of driving to a certain degree the pace of the programming and also the intensity of the programming, because they feel like, okay, I've got this. It's a continual check-in. I feel good now. You know, where can I go from here? I think that that's not just wonderful to do. I think it's imperative. Yeah.
Absolutely. And like you said, it can change from day to day.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah. And absolutely. So an example I think of, I have three friends now that have given birth in the last 5 months. And
wow.
One of them was a high level athlete. She played international professional volleyball. Wow. And she's like not super excited about her body right now.
Yeah.
Her son. So an example that I want to share with you guys is like, if you had a client like that, who maybe isn't comfortable in their own skin in the moment, right? They're just not feeling, you know, good about themselves for whatever reason. And that's their emotion to feel. They're okay to feel first of all. But if they walk into the gym, you can ask them, are you okay training out on the main floor today? Or would you like to go somewhere more private?
Jenny, that's so true. That's so true. And really, you know, to that point of not being super excited about their body right now. I mean, having a baby, and again, we can go on for days probably, but having a baby is a huge moment, not just physically, but mentally, emotionally. So like all of a sudden you were pregnant and then now you're a mom and you're responsible for another human being, quite often with your own body, not always, but sometimes with your own body, keeping them alive. And you look down at this body that you don't recognize.
Yes.
And there's an identity shift, because especially if you're an athlete, you have an athletic mindset. You still have that athletic mindset. You look down and you ask your body to do something, like, I don't know, even just a small crunch or some sort of engagement. The brain says, I got it. The body says, what? Because there's a disconnect. And so there's so many mental, emotional, and physical pieces to rehabilitation after having a baby that one question of where do you feel comfortable today will change from yesterday to tomorrow, but where are you today? Mm-hmm. And giving those options it changes everything, because it means that you are, as a trainer, recognize that this person is an evolving human and is in a very different state of identity, and day to day that can shift. So I love that you mentioned that, because that is, it feels so small and it's huge.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely. Well, Farel, your passion for this, absolutely love it. Back for part two. So guys, this is to be continued. Make sure you guys watch episode two. But Farel, where can our viewers find you if they'd like to check you out and ask you some questions?
Absolutely. So Instagram is someplace that I'm there. It's not all professional on Instagram. It definitely is my journey as a human. But also just emailing me at farelhruska@gmail.com. I'd be more than happy. I do have some courses on various, you know, certifying bodies and things like that. So if you want to reach out to me, I'm happy to help. But I'm just proud to be on this podcast with you.
Yes. And now I know you've worked with ACE Fitness before, right?
I have. Yes. ACE and IDEA. Yeah. And then other educational bodies that are a little bit more international. But yeah.
Nice. Well, what I'll do is I'll get a list of those courses from you and we'll put it in the description of our episode. So our viewers can reach out and take any of those courses if they're interested. Cause we get asked almost on a daily basis on our Facebook page, do we have a women's fitness or women's health? I actually had one question this morning. So really? I'll make sure to get that out to everyone. Yes. Okay. Yeah. And people are like, well, you guys are ISSA. Why are you talking about other certification companies? Guys, education comes from everywhere. Absolutely. We don't have it all. And there's so much out there. Expand your horizons, open your mind.
Exactly.
Yes. So I will definitely get a list. We'll put that in the description. I'll make sure to post it on Facebook today as well.
Thanks, Jenny.
Yes. And Farel, thank you so much for joining us. I look forward to our next episode.
Sounds good.
Awesome. And thank you guys for watching. Be sure to tune in for episode 2, because we're going to continue this conversation. Thanks for watching, guys.